Hi there. Well, it's the beginning of January. Rather chilly afternoon. It's about 3 o'clock and in an hour it'll be dark. We are on another lockdown. And I'm out on a permitted exercise. And if I stop walking, that is classed as rest. And it could encourage socialization, so I must keep moving. Anyway, I've decided to put together another video. This is one I've been planning to do for some time, and it's basically based on a visit to Normandy, France, loosely around the D-Day invasion beaches, but not just that. These are mainly photographs that I've taken over many years. Some are quite old, but I hope you enjoy it. So, what better place to start than near my hometown of Dartmouth? These beaches, back in the mid-1940s, were the center of action for Operation Tiger, where the United States forces basically took over these beaches and did their rehearsals for D-Day. This memorial was presented to the people of the villages who left their homes to allow the United States Army to rehearse and practice for the assault on Normandy in June 1944. These are a couple of then and now photos which show what the beaches were like back in 1944 and how they look today. Quite amazing really to think what was going on. And I have to tell you that 5 miles away where my parents lived, nobody had one clue what was going on just down the coast. This is a list of names of people that were very tragically killed when their landing craft was sunk by a German U-boat out in Lime Bay on one of the rehearsals. Of course, they thought they'd swept the area and the place was clear of Germans, but it wasn't. This old tank was pulled out of the mud maybe 25 years ago and now serves as a memorial to the people that lost their lives there. Now, you may be wondering what the relevance is of these next few slides is. Well, this depicts the very last invasion of England in 1066, the Norman conquest. And this is the Bayeux Tapestry, which hopefully you will get to see when you visit Bayeux, which is the town where I normally base people when we go on this trip. So, but before we cross to Bayeux, before we cross to France, we will go along the coast to Portsmouth, England, where the antithesis of the Bayeux Tapestry, the Overlord Embroidery, is in a museum just near Portsmouth. And this shows basically what the story of what happened on the 6th of June 1944, where the greatest invasion ever took place of Normandy. So I think it's just interesting to compare the story of the two. So there are different ways to get to France. You can go by the Channel, the Euro Tunnel, but that's further up to Dover. We have to get to go that way. So from Portsmouth, you can either go by fast ferry or rather slow ferry. So this is one of the fast ferries that gets across in about three and a half hours. We usually arrive in France in Cherbourg, and traveling down the Cherbourg Peninsula, the first place I tend to visit is Utah Beach, which is an American beach. And you can sort of compare and contrast what you saw at Slapton. See another one of the old tanks. One of the major differences between Slapton and Utah Beach is that the tide goes out a long way. There were similarities, and in Slapton they could at least practice landing on the beach and also practice scaling cliffs that you'll see a little bit later on, which were actually on the Omaha Beach. So we now move on to the nearby town of Saint-Mer at Glise, which was made very famous in the movie The Longest Day, where an American airman got caught on the roof of the church and was hanging there by his parachute for some time before he was cut down. This next slide also is an interesting story that's worth just reading a minute. And now, courtesy of Google Street View, you can see that the house is now a ice cream cafe. So next, there are a few photos of the beautiful Normandy town of Bayeux with its stunning architecture. This is where you will see the Bayeux tapestry at some stage, I hope, during your stay. But it's a lovely town, and I have to say they really do make Americans very welcome here, not forgetting what happened back in 1944. This is the British military cemetery in Bayeux. And I have to say, you can get a very nice seafood fruit de mer meal here. Lovely markets. And fish, of course. This island citadel is just off the coast of Brittany and is an interesting place to visit, but I warn you, it does get absolutely rammed with tourists. It was in 2004, on the 60th anniversary of D-Day, that the German government was first invited to participate in the D-Day celebrations, as the Major said to Basil Fawlty in Fawlty Towers, forgive and forget Fawlty. This is the German War Cemetery, which is a little bit more modest than the some of the others you will see in Normandy. I would expect that anybody going on a D-Day tour of Normandy would have seen the movie The Longest Day. And one of the most memorable parts of the movie were when the German officer was looking through his binoculars and saw the oncoming massive fleet of ships on the horizon. And then their attempts to wake the Führer back in Berlin to tell them that the invasion had started in a place where they didn't expect it to start. Don't you think it seems quite poignant that we see these red poppies growing wild in the wheat field? And we're heading out now for a full day on the Normandy beaches. First thing I thought we could just briefly do is to recap where the training was done in Slapton. So you will see the similarity between the beaches in Slapton and also the beaches in Normandy, and also the cliffs that they had to scale. So the first place we head for is Point de Hoc, which is a high promontory of land, the highest point between Utah and Omaha beaches, as you can see from this map. And basically, the idea was that it would be bombarded a few days before D-Day, and then the Rangers would land, and using grappling hooks, they would scale the 100-foot cliffs. In actual fact, they met little resistance from gun emplacements on the cliffs, because the destruction has been so heavy in the previous few weeks that they were quite astonished by the destruction they found. It's amazing while you're here that you can see for yourself the difficulties that these people would have had to engage, and just the strength of the military defences that the Germans had built, some of which had been destroyed, but some of which will be here literally forever. This is Omaha Beach, and probably the most famous of the American landing beaches on D-Day, and it's where they hold the celebrations every year. These photos here show some of the people who I've taken there, including couple who are there having lunch on the beach. And I did wonder whether this was sacrilegious to do this, but then I thought, no, this is why the war was fought, so that people could be free and enjoy the beach in the way that it's supposed to be enjoyed. Looking up from Omaha Beach to the top of the hill there, which is where the immensely moving and incredible American War Cemetery is. I have to say that I've been here many, many times, but on each time that I come, I can't help but be incredibly moved by the sight of all the crosses and also the occasional Jewish symbol as well. That being said, you have to see an ironic side to it, where the sign is for the American War Cemetery. And in the background, what do we see but the local McDonald's is here waiting for people who will visit, making them feel like home. The music you hear playing in the background is something I recorded myself when I was last there. There was a joint choir from Minnesota and Michigan, and you'll probably agree that the music is absolutely beautiful. And it was on a rainy day, which almost made the whole thing more relevant, I suppose. The other thing that's interesting here is the graves of the Nyland brothers. They were who the movie Saving Private Ryan was actually based on, and their graves are here, and it's a very interesting story about that family, the tragedy of that family. Further along the coast, this is Aramarsh, which is a British beach. The particular interest of this beach is, this is where the Mulberry Harbour was built. And believe it or not, you can still see the remains of the harbour that was built here to land tanks and ordnance and trucks and whatever was needed to support the war in Normandy. Ironically, they very quickly captured Cherbourg, so the harbour wasn't really used in the end, particularly after it got destroyed, or part of it got destroyed in an exceptionally strong storm that took place just after the D-Day landings. So it was fortunate that they captured the port of Cherbourg in order to get all the stuff in that they needed. Again, travelling further along the coast, we go arrive in Corcelles-sur-Mer. And you can see that Dartmouth, my hometown, is twinned with this town on the coast. This is Pegasus Bridge, very famous because it is next to the town of Ranville, which was the first town in France to be liberated. In the hours just before D-Day, when British soldiers arrived in their canvas-made gliders and flew in, and their objective was to take this bridge so that the advancing troops from the beaches the following day would be able to move freely through. The interesting thing about this place is this cafe looks the same as it did back in the war, and immediately the British liberated the bridge and took the bridge. A sign was put outside the cafe saying English spoken, and it's still there. You can see it. It's an interesting place to visit. Just a few photos here from the Col Museum, which I have to say, no visit to Normandy is complete without going to this museum, which is probably the most amazing military museum that I've ever seen. And actually it covers, of course, the Second World War, but also part of the First World War and continuing on to the present day. It is an amazing place, and to be honest, you need a day to see it, and I realise that is a big commitment, but you really do need a day to see it. But visiting this part of France really is not all about the Second World War. There are plenty of other things to see and do as well, apart from the fact that it's an absolutely gorgeous countryside here and a very atmospheric place. One of the places I like to take people is to the Claude Monet, the painter's garden at his house in Giverny. Very interesting and a lovely place to visit, although you need to time it right because it can get extremely busy. And now to something a little bit more recreational, which is France, of course, is known for food. And it's all about cheese and picnics and pâté and wine, and I know lots of little picnic places off the beaten track where we can go and eat. One of the most interesting places is Camembert. Camembert cheese is for the most part made in big factories, and but this particular Camembert farm in the village of Camembert is still making cheese, and I can tell you it is absolutely delicious. My mouth is watering as I tell you about it now. And typically we go and have a look at the cheese, see how it's made, buy some cheese that is ready to eat, buy some lovely crusty bread and maybe some tomatoes and a bit of salad and stuff, and then go off and find somewhere to consume what we bought. The other shots that you see here are taken with various people at various picnics that we've had in the middle of fields and in picnic sites where benches have been set up, just to show the kind of thing you can do for lunch in Normandy, really. Great fun. Can't resist it. Just a few more photos of things I like to eat in France. Tartiflette is beautiful. Potatoes and cheese, onions. The breakfast, bread and jam in France, absolutely gorgeous. And I love the eclairs. Absolutely amazing. Honfleur is a fishing harbour town, and for me it is an absolute jewel in the crown on the north coast of France. Absolutely beautiful, the most amazing architecture, very atmospheric place, lovely place to eat around the harbour side. It is just a wonderful, typical French town, and to think that you're only, you know, 60 miles or so away from the south coast of England, yet everything is so different. I love it there. I try and get people to go there, and they're all absolutely spellbound with the place. Gorgeous town, Honfleur. And finally, just a few shots here that I've got from Rouen, which is a stunning city in northern France. A lot of people drive around it, but if you go through it, you will appreciate the fantastic architecture and the markets, and there's some lovely places to stay there, fantastic restaurants. And yeah, it's somewhere not to be missed if you're in northern France. And finally, you'll remember we came over by ferry from Portsmouth to Cherbourg. Well, I often go back from near Calais on the Channel Tunnel, or Channel as people know it by. I do this because A, it's something different, we're not backtracking, but also I'm often dropping people in London, and that would be that is the most convenient way of doing it. So literally you just turn up at the tunnel terminal, drive onto a train, and it takes about 25 or 30 minutes to get through the tunnel on the train. It's amazing, actually my sat-nav even works for part of it. But you can see from the shot where with the cars there, you can open the doors of the car and get out and stretch your legs. It's all pretty easy to do. Well, that's it, guys. I hope you enjoyed it. And it might move you to want to do something like this one day. If you enjoyed this video, you can do what they always ask. Give me the thumbs up and subscribe down below if you want to see some more videos like this. Thank you for watching.